Well, good morning. Welcome to NYU. Welcome to our symposium on the developments in domestic and international financial regulation. I'm Peter Horn. I'm editor-in-chief of the NYU Journal of Law and Business, which is NYU's only journal at the intersection of law and business and one of the leading publications nationwide in this field. We publish a balance of academic and practitioner pieces and publish three issues a year, as well as a substantial amount of programming, including our annual symposium. This is our 10th annual symposium, and each year we pick a topic at the cutting edge of law and business. Over the past several years, we've built up some institutional knowledge in financial regulation in particular. In 2009, we held a conference on financial regulation just as the credit crisis and the financial crisis was taking shape. And now, today, we can look at these regulations just as they're coming into effect, look at the future possibilities for them, and see how they've taken shape in the US and abroad. So today we have three panels and a keynote address with academics, lawyers, bankers, consultants, and regulators. And we look forward to the discussion. Now a few special words. First, thanks to the journal and all the members for helping us put this on. Thanks to Law and Business at NYU, and in particular, Professors Karen Brenner, Helen Scott, and Gerald Rosenfeld. Thanks to the Dean of NYU Law, Dean Morrison, for his support. NYU Law Symposium Fund, the Pollack Center for Law and Business at NYU, and David Mora and Tom Sarf with Student Affairs. I also want to thank our managing editors, David Holmberg, and in particular, Les Krusen, who's done a great job putting this together. So thanks again, and hope you enjoy the day. Here's Les.
All right, well, thank you, Peter. With that, I'd just like to thank all the panelists and the audience members for braving the weather and making it here. Again, we're very pleased to put this on, and while this won't be the first or the last conference on financial regulation, we do think that this is set apart in some respects, in that we've managed to take a very international focus to the event. Also, we're able to look at these regulations now that a number of the regulations are beginning to come online. And then lastly, we have been able to include a number of professors from business schools, including Stern and Wharton. And so that's a rare thing to be able to pull off at a law school. So just a brief overview of the panels. We're going to start off with one panel focusing on Dodd-Frank and Title VII derivatives reform. And particularly, we're going to try and take a look at the state of Dodd-Frank as it is today, many years down the line. We're also going to try and take a look at sort of the process by which the statute of Dodd-Frank was turned into workable regulations. And then the second panel is going to take an even broader perspective and consider some of the European regulations that are coming online. Now, this is particularly important because they're following, in some respects, the United States as a first mover in the field. But in other respects, they're going their own way. And this creates a number of challenges for businesses. And businesses also have to grapple with the issues of extraterritoriality of the reforms, as well as the degree to which they're going to be able to find substitutive compliance. So our final panel will be focusing on the actual impact of all these regulations on the businesses themselves. And so this, again, is going to be a very broad look at to what degree are these regulations having the effect that they're meant to do. To what degree will these help prevent future financial crises? And to what extent may there be regulatory retrenchment in the future? So with that, I'd like to just take a moment or two to thank a couple of people who have played a key role in putting this panel together. First, I'd like to thank Professor Alan Retzthoff in absentia for introducing me to the subject. If someone had asked me a year ago what a derivatives was, I would have panicked and ran to Wikipedia to try and figure it out. In that class, I was also introduced to one of the panelists, Ryne Miller, who took time out of his day when he was at the CFTC to really help me identify the topic and scope of the conference. Truly a rising star in the derivatives legal world. I'd also like to thank Ken Raisler, also with Sullivan and Cromwell, who lent his name to this effort and also helped provide some guidance and contacts. He's also a member of the Board of Trustees at NYU School of Law. So again, we're very pleased to have you here. Additionally, I'd like to thank Lori Ferber, who is floating around here somewhere, for her tireless efforts, fervent, I might say, in helping to put this panel together. She's also a life trustee at NYU School of Law, and we greatly appreciate all of your effort. And lastly, just to all the panelists, all the participants, I know a number of favors were called in. I appreciate that, and I owe to whatever meager extent I can a debt to you guys. So again, thank you, and I'll hand it off to Dean Trevor Morrison, who's in his first year, and hopefully will do a number of welcome addresses to us.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks, Les, and thanks, Peter. I'm glad to be here to help kick off the beginning of this symposium, and I really do want to congratulate the Journal of Law and Business. I suppose anytime you pick as the topic current developments in, you're sort of guaranteeing definitionally that you'll be topical and of current relevance. But there is, I think, as we've already heard, a real currency and an importance to the scope of what we'll be looking at today. I think these days there is no such thing as purely domestic financial regulation. So given the players that are being regulated here, given the spaces that they operate in, there is inevitably a transnational dimension to domestic financial regulation. And then the financial regulatory efforts elsewhere in the world, whether they're in a single jurisdiction or across jurisdictions, themselves inevitably have profound domestic impacts. And so this is a set of questions that really needs examining. And I think the other thing it reflects is how well situated we are here at NYU to do that examining. As many of you know, over the last decade in particular, the intersection of law and business is something that the law school has really focused on training our students in, providing greater curriculum in that area, looking at it as an opportunity to be partnering with Stern in particular, and preparing people for careers at the intersection of law and business, whether that starts on the legal practice side and moves over time, say from a firm to in-house, and maybe even from the law side to the business side, or starts more on the business side, understanding that having a grounding in both the sort of core principles of business practice and relevant law is critical to career success. And in fact, those insights, I think, are also critical to smart regulation in this space. And I suspect we might all agree that the ratio of regulation to smart regulation is not 1-to-1 in this area. And so that highlights the value of great expertise in this domain. And it's the expertise that we're trying to make sure that we are steeping our students in during their time here, those who are interested in this area. I think today's symposium is also a great reflection of the possibilities of collaboration among academics from different disciplines, but then connecting academics to the private sector and to the public sector as well. So it really is a pleasure to be welcoming here professors from multiple disciplines, friends of the law school, including our trustee Ken Raisler, our life trustee Lori Ferber, and other alums of the law school. And also then practitioners, whether or not previously connected to NYU and the private sector and public sectors alike. Just the roster of personnel today reflects the deep importance of this set of issues, the way that the issues cut across disciplinary boundaries, practice boundaries, public and private as well. So I think we're in for a great day, and really it's just my job to congratulate the journal on putting together such a great event, to welcome all of you and wish you well for the symposium. Thanks so much.
So without further ado, we will get started with our first panel, updates on Dodd-Frank derivatives reform. And as I already introduced, Ryne Miller, formerly of the CFTC, now with Sullivan and Cromwell, Ken Reisler, Sullivan and Cromwell as well, and Gordon Kiesling of UBS. So I'll leave it in their capable hands at this point. Thank you.
Thanks very much, and welcome everybody, and our appreciation for those of you who got up earlier than they might normally get up to appear with us today. We welcome your asking questions throughout the program, not just at the end. It might make the interaction a little bit more spirited. I would warn you, however, there the program is being recorded, so you may want to take that into account as you ask your questions, although I don't think there's any such thing as a bad question, although I can't say that with respect to the answer. So, but anyway, please do participate. The views expressed here are our own, maybe a little bit controversial. Certainly, many of you might disagree with them, and so if you have a different view, we welcome that in the dialogue as well. To set up the discussion on Dodd-Frank, I think it's important to sort of talk about the economic climate rolling up to what was the recession that started, I think, fundamentally in 2008. And, you know, you'll hear, actually, our keynote speaker, Jess Staley, was really on the front lines for a lot of that, and I think his perspective on the roll-up to the recession and then Dodd-Frank is particularly useful and important. But I'll give some sort of views and thoughts and hopefully inspire some conversation from the panel and others. I think one of the things that's particularly unusual about the Dodd-Frank Act, from my point of view, is it was really written before, and I would submit even today, probably still before, people had really figured out what caused the recession, what were the root causes of it, and what were the problems that needed to be solved. And so I think Congress, probably at the behest of the public at large, felt it was important to develop legislation to address what they believed to be some of the core issues around the recession and the financial collapse in 2008 that rolled us into 2009. And Dodd-Frank, if you'll recall, was adopted in July of 2010. But there really wasn't a whole lot of agreement on what those elements were. But there were a few elements that I will highlight that speak specifically to the issues that made up Dodd-Frank, and specifically in the area of derivatives. But there are a lot of other issues that I would submit were not addressed, and perhaps one could argue still have not been effectively addressed. I think the first issue, obviously, is the economic environment that we had coming into 2008. And I think some people focus there on and have chronicled that as a housing bubble, or at least a speculative bubble in terms of valuations and the way in which people were leveraging assets to make money, or at least make money on paper, which created a frail environment for activity. I think that the housing bubble and the issues surrounding the GSEs, particularly Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, are issues that I think are still largely unresolved. And, you know, certainly some publications, particularly the Wall Street Journal, repeatedly kind of come back to those issues and argue that they do need to be addressed and haven't been. And I think those issues largely are not part of Dodd-Frank, even though they're a core part of what was a root cause of some of the calamities that we saw in 2008 and 2009. I think the other point in terms of that economic environment is that the United States felt it important to move aggressively and move forward in 2010, knowing, and we'll have comments on this at the later panels, knowing that their counterparts in other jurisdictions around the world, obviously sort of in a headquarter way in the EU and in Asia, were not ready to develop legislation, were not convinced that the parameters had been fully defined, were not convinced that they knew all of the root causes. And the decision that was made by the US Congress after some considerable discussion and debate was that the United States needed to move forward first. If they waited for their counterparts in other jurisdictions, they may never get off the ground, and that the calamity was such that the public needed, the American public, a U.S. public, needed something by way of solution and by way of positive action, and that waiting for their brethren in other jurisdictions would be too slow and too long. And certainly we'll have some discussion about that in the next two panels that you're going to be hearing from today. You know, when we think about the economic environment, we think about that, for me, in the context of three subcategories, sort of the entities that are affected, and I mentioned Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac as examples of that, the products that are affected, and the regulators that are involved. And as far as entities go, obviously, in addition to Fannie and Freddie, we have issues around the banks, their safety and soundness, the issues around too big to fail, a term that I'm sure will be used several times during the course of today, and you know, whether they're adequately regulated in some of their activities, most specifically whether they're adequately regulated in their trading and dealing in derivatives, which is going to be the core topic for us to discuss here. In addition to the banks themselves, there were a number of unregulated, I would say generally unregulated entities, although people could disagree with what the word regulation means in that sentence, but largely unregulated entities that were also engaged in derivatives activities, and it was felt that some of those entities exposed the economy, exposed themselves to real risk, and that there needed to be some looking at the entity's activities on a going forward basis. And the poster child for that discussion would be AIG Financial Products. AIG itself, of course, a well-known insurance entity, but operating its derivatives business out of an affiliate that was not regulated per se as an insurance company. And although equal arguments about the degree to which insurance companies like banks were regulated in their derivatives dealing generally, but specifically AIG sought to operate their derivatives business outside of the insurance company, and obviously we saw some calamitous events there and a huge leveraged exposure and the need for a substantial loan from the government to keep that company afloat and to make sure that its counterparties also didn't fail. In the products area, obviously, the key product that we're going to be talking about today is the is OTC derivatives, and sort of whether that product was adequately regulated. Obviously, Dodd-Frank's conclusion that would be Chris Dodd and Barney Frank, but also virtually every Democrat in Congress was of the view that OTC derivatives needed to be more aggressively regulated, and that brought on the Dodd-Frank Act. But in addition, there are a whole variety of other products. Subprime mortgages, again, going back to my housing theme, were a big issue for risk and leveraged exposure. The collateralized various debt and loan obligations and a variety of other new products that are outside of the strict OTC derivatives space were also of import to the calamity here and the exposures that people had. And I think there was some feeling then, and I think that feeling even carries forward today, that a lot of people didn't fully understand the risks of these products. They hadn't really been fully tested in disastrous economic environments, and that what is commonly called black swan events had not been analyzed with respect to these activities. And so products were a big part. Then the last category, and I'm going to turn it over to Gordon to give us his thoughts about the run-up to the recession. But the last category was the issue of regulators. And here, the issue is really the same sort of basic theme, which is that, yes, there were regulators that could have had responsibility for the activity, but fundamentally, the underlying instruments were not adequately regulated by whether it be the CFTC or the SEC or the bank regulators or the state regulators, if you wanted to get that granular. And as a result of that, there were gaps in oversight. The goal of Dodd-Frank, as we'll discuss in much more detail, was to try to corral that unregulated activity and place it under a specific regulator's responsibility in order to reduce, eliminate, probably eliminate is way too ambitious, but reduce the risks that these products had and make sure through disclosure and a variety of other things we'll talk about that that the buyers of these products would have a better idea of what they were getting into and that the sellers of these products would adequately margin, capitalize, and otherwise evaluate the risks as well. So I don't know, Gordon, your thoughts about the roll-up to the recession. You were looking at it from inside a bank and sort of how did that calamity look to you?
Yeah, I mean, I would say in the run-up to the financial crisis, I mean, what you know, you had a market with, you know, essentially an unregulated OTC derivatives market in which private counterparties transacted with one another and were free to transact with one another and agree on the terms of almost an unlimited variety of OTC contracts, many of which involved essentially extending credit from one counterparty to another. in the credit derivative space. For instance, you know, Ken, you referred to AIG FP as one of the poster childs. We had AIG Financial Products, for instance, was a counterparty that wrote an enormous amount of credit default protection to counterparties across the street. The the more sophisticated counterparties, such as the investment banks, collected collateral from AIG in order to protect themselves against the credit risk of a failure to perform. Less sophisticated counterparties perhaps didn't collect as much collateral. That process of writing large amounts of exposure and entering into a wide variety of derivatives was repeated across the entire spectrum, I think, of swap dealers and a large spectrum of counterparties. And when the in my judgment, when the credit or when the financial crisis occurred and there was a massive contraction generally in available credit, that triggered the development of some very large exposures requiring the posting of collateral. And again, just to look at our example, the inability at AIG FP triggered what we could call a de facto default by AIG FP and a chain of events that then rippled out, given the very interconnected nature in that case of the CDS market, rippled out across the entire dealer community. So I as Ken mentioned, that one segment of the OTC derivatives market, credit default swaps, became sort of a emblematic of the risks or the perceived risks of essentially the unregulated trading and creation of OTC derivative positions, triggering the actions we saw by Congress in terms of the Dodd-Frank Act.
Yeah, I think it's worth mentioning. I mean, I think that most practitioners and most people in the financial services sector realize the great value that credit default swaps as a new instrument provided to the marketplace and had huge potential benefits of risk management for participants. The only complication of a credit default swap is there are two credits in a credit default swap. And many times people forgot the fact that not only were you buying or selling credit risk on an underlying company in terms of their debt or their default risk, but you're also buying or selling credit risk on the issuer of the credit default swap. And so if you didn't value that second risk in your equation, then you were missing the bigger, what turned out to be the bigger risk, certainly around Dodd-Frank events and the recession itself. Let me just sort of, and we'll have a chance with Jess Staley to talk a little bit more about the roll-up to Dodd-Frank, but let me talk generally and then we'll turn it over to Ryne to drill in some more detail. Talk generally about the goals of Dodd-Frank, and I think that there was, to the credit of Congress and the market participants who were involved in the development of the Dodd-Frank Act, there were, in fact, concrete goals, and I guess, what I would hope people would do in the years to come is measure the success of Dodd-Frank against these goals and see whether, in fact, it did achieve what it was intended to do. And again, Dodd-Frank Act, if I can, sort of oversimplify it, is very much focused on this OTC derivative space. I think there are two overarching goals of Dodd-Frank, which can actually be half a line each. One is to bring transparency and competition to the swaps market, and we can talk in a lot of detail about what that means. But the basic point of that, I'll come back to that in a minute. And then the second is to prevent the risks of the financial sector infecting the real economy. And I think that, again, if I can come back to my too big to fail, that really is sort of expressed in the too big to fail. The idea is that, and you've heard this quite a bit, is that the activities of money center banks, largely headquartered either on the East Coast or in many cases in Europe, would not have an effect on Main Street in middle America. And in fact, it did. Now, I think a lot of that impact was less derivatives and more housing bubble. But nonetheless, the idea being that we need to be more confident that through a regulatory regime that our OTC derivative space is properly overseen and managed in a variety of ways. So what do we try to do to accomplish those two goals? basically we're going to be regulating the OTC derivatives activities in a couple of different ways. We're going to be regulating the product by requiring the people who sell it to engage in various internal and external business conduct rules and the terms of the contract having been defined. We're going to regulate the participants. And by that, we are basically going to register people as swap dealers, and Ryne will talk in more detail about that, and make sure that anybody who is marketing these products is subject to a regulatory regime, registration, exams, audits, and the like. And this, for the most part, falls to the CFTC with respect to OTC derivatives, although Gordon will talk a little bit about the role of the SEC, which is not in any way irrelevant, specifically around security-based derivatives. The scope of the regulation of the participants and the product is something that Ryne will talk more granularly about in terms of what the CFTC specifically has done. In addition, there will be reporting of all of those transactions. That report will go to the government and also on a no-names basis, also out to the public. There was a strong feeling that the swaps market was an opaque market, that the buyers of the swaps, and I'm not sure how true this is, and certainly a number of the buyers took a different view, but that the buyers of the swaps were not knowledgeable and did not have access to information about the swap transaction and its risks, such that they were not making informed decisions when they were participating. And so there are now obligations on the seller of the swap to make sure that the buyer gets a whole variety of disclosures, both specific and general, and that, you know, that becomes a key part of the experience. And then the other area is basically execution and clearing, and we'll spend quite a bit of time talking about this. This is really, clearing a little bit less revolutionary. There was some migration toward clearing even before Dodd-Frank, and actually substantial migration in the interest rate swap space toward clearing. Clearing basically being taking the risk away from the party's risk to its counterparty and moving that risk to a central repository, a clearinghouse for such risk. The idea being that by concentrating the risk in the clearinghouse, taking it away from the counterparty, you avoid the sort of incremental risks that that caused many of the panics that the Gordon talked about, and particularly the one that impacted AIG and their inability to come up with margin. Associated with clearing would be capital requirements and margin requirements in order to make sure that the particular positions are adequately secured, both by the seller having adequate capital and also by there being a sufficient margin up for the transaction so that the clearinghouse is adequately capitalized. A huge initiative and one that's underway, and we'll talk in more detail about that. And then the last piece was to create public execution environments for these transactions. That is, instead of there being bilateral, and a bilateral trade could be cleared and in fact can still be cleared, but instead of the trades being bilateral, which would be, of course, opaque, at least limited to those two parties, there would be a general open forum where prices would be discovered and where people could execute their transactions on an open environment way. And these are the development of something called swap execution facilities, or SEFs, will be talked about a good bit. So let me turn it over to Ryne to kind of tell us how we're moving forward in this this broad-based initiative.
Sure. Thanks, Ken. The way I want to approach this is to offer some perspective from the Washington side and then from the interfacing of the business side with Washington as to how we go from a statute to proposed rules to final rules and then an implementation process. With Dodd-Frank, particularly over the last, I guess, 4 years now, that has very much been the story, which is how do we move from the political agreement that we have reached in Congress to pass the Dodd-Frank Act to more specific and detailed regulations and substance that will become the new regime that market participants will have to follow. The legislative model we have in the United States, in the way in which the legislative branch interacts with the executive branch, is that Congress does reach a political agreement in terms of a statute. And many times when you go to the statute, it's more than issue spotting, but it is less than detailed requirements that are going to be applied in practice and in business. And so what we in theory have is an executive branch and executive agencies that come in as the technicians or as the refiners or interpreters of the statute and of the broad-based political agreements from the statute, and they turn those into regulations, codified regulations. And that is a process that is known really under the administrative procedures process in the United States, where an agency takes the law, they do proposals, and then they go through a public comment process, and then they end up with final rules that are going to implement the statute that Congress passed. On the CFTC with Dodd-Frank, there was certainly, it went beyond technician implementation of a statute, and that is I'm trying to think. So on the CFTC side, as they went to implement Dodd-Frank, they went through a series of proposed rules. There were more than 100 proposals to cover the open issues, the unfinished issues that were left in the statute. In the proposals, we really identified four key substantive areas that were going to be addressed. We had to make rules that would cover registration of market participants, and the most important registration category was for swap dealers. So these are in the next category that we had to cover in terms of the substantive areas of Dodd-Frank were the reporting requirements, which Ken alluded to earlier. The third issue, and this was more of a broad-based kind of the policy decision of Dodd-Frank, was central clearing. And the rules were then going to decide which products would be covered by central clearing and which market participants would be subject to central clearing. And then the fourth substantive area that we had to go through in the rule writing process was the exchange trading, or the requirement that trades be brought into a public and non-bilateral space. So I just want to talk through the proposal process and what that involves on the agency side. Typically, for example, the CFTC had five commissioners. In a normal administration, you're going to have three commissioners from the political party of the president or the administration, and then two commissioners from the political party of the other side. So in 2010, we had three Democratic commissioners and two Republican commissioners. And so what that builds into the process is hopefully a consensus-building effort that the rules that will implement the statute will carry over the political agreement that was reached in Congress. And so the CFTC does this by building a draft proposed rule that is an issue to the public, and the public is able to review that and submit comments. And it's this comment process which becomes the sort of second round, we don't want to say negotiation, but the second round to review the political agreement that had been reached in Congress. And so through the comment process, we see the different interested parties start to come in to the agency, evaluate the rules that the agency has proposed, and start to work with and either advise or engage in discussion with the agency on fine-tuning the proposal to reach a final rule that will become regulation.
Just a thought to interrupt, sorry, Ryan, is that sort of to some extent the CFTC is a microcosm of the discord in Washington, in the sense, as Ryan outlined, is that, as many of you know, Dodd-Frank actually passed the Congress without a single Republican vote. It was able to do that with the majority that occurred, with Scott Brown sort of being kind of in the mix there. And as a result, the Republicans didn't feel that they owned or had any responsibility to Dodd-Frank, and that actually carried over even to the commission, which historically had been a 5-0 agency. Virtually nothing had been done other than by consensus at the agency, but there was a feeling among the two Republican commissioners that a number of these initiatives had gone too far, that they were over the top in terms of both their complexity and their rigor. And so there was, as we see in Congress every day, there was a sort of unusual political split at the CFTC, which probably in many respects was unhealthy in terms of getting these rules done in a more expedited way.
Right. So I think the best way to go through it is to start with one of the four subject matter areas that were going to be implemented, and let's look at the swap dealer registration process. So the commission, working from the statute, which directed the agency to require swap dealers to register with the CFTC. This is a new category of registration. Historically, we've only really required, on the commodity side, the regulation of brokers, whether it's a futures commission merchant or an introducing broker, someone who is intermediating a customer or a trader to an exchange type market. What we saw with swap dealer registration is a new paradigm where those market participants or market players, for example, the large banks is what we historically think of, that are not intermediating but are entering into transactions on a principal basis, were going to be registered solely by that activity, which is entering into transactions on a principal basis. So the questions that we had to address to implement a registration rule was, who would it cover? What would be the size or perhaps the scope of the products that could cause someone to be subject to regulation? And then what types of requirements or duties were going to apply to this entity once it was regulated? The first question you saw, which is which entities should be registered as swap dealers, the agency had to dive into who in the market is acting on a principal basis, standing available to make markets, who is acting in a dealer capacity rather than entering into derivatives as a customer. And so clearly, the agency's rules covered what we call the large banks. So I think UBS is where Gordon is at, and several other banks. They serve a function in the market. They stand open to meet the terms of a swap for a customer. And so the CFTC was pretty comfortable there that if you're looking at a financial entity that is doing a significant volume of what they called swap dealing activity, that type of entity was going to be registered as a swap dealer, and that's what Congress was intending in the Dodd-Frank Act. The CFTC then went forward and started to examine where else in the market do we have either enterprises, companies, whether end users or not commercial end users or otherwise, are also engaging in a similar activity, and where are they doing so at a level that is significant enough to require them to be registered with the CFTC. The inquiry really started with maybe with energy companies, but with companies that are really heavily engaged in the physical commodity business, but that were also using that knowledge to engage in a derivatives business at the same time, both to hedge their market activity, but also to use their expertise in the physical commodities business to have separate businesses that involve trading activity. So the CFTC issued a proposal. And the numbers here are going to sound large, but when you consider the scope of the derivatives market, they're not really as large as they sound. And so the CFTC proposed to require swap dealers to register if they were doing a notional amount of swaps, I believe in the $100 million level. And so as companies started to review that proposal, and to give some background, the derivatives market is generally categorized at either 300 trillion in the US or even larger, maybe 700 trillion on the global basis of open notional contracts. And so $100 million in the context of a $300 trillion market, notional value, is not a large threshold at all. And as companies started to review this proposal, energy companies, very small banks, companies that considered themselves solely end users of derivatives realized that they may exceed this $100 million threshold and be covered by the Dodd-Frank regulation that was intended to resolve the concerns that led to the financial crisis. And so the first round of comments the commission received on the proposal was, is this number really calibrated in the right way? Is $100 million, although it sounds as if it's a large number, is that unnecessarily small to bring in an inappropriate number of swap dealers that would have to register? And to show how the comment process worked itself through, a year and a half after the proposal, the commission issued final rules and what they call the de minimis level, or the level of swap dealing activity that would require an entity to register, was raised to $8 billion, so approximately 80 times the proposed level. And what that shows is not only that the commission itself was still learning about the swaps market and the nature of the activities in the swaps market, but that the commission had not fully evaluated the potential impact or unintended consequences of the regulations that it was proposing. And so as we move forward from swap dealer, the final swap dealer rules, the $8 billion level did emerge as a number that was workable. Most of the large banks, particularly those with a U.S. presence, have determined that they exceed that number, and the number is applied typically on a 12-month rolling basis. And so we have in the range of 80 registered swap dealers, and the majority of those are banking entities. There are a couple energy, large energy companies that maintain significant derivatives desks that have registered as swap dealers as well. But on the whole, I think the industry is comfortable, the derivatives industry is comfortable that the swap dealer number was calibrated correctly, and they think that as a result of the comment process that the commission goes through between a proposed rule and a final rule.
This is again an example of an accelerated rulemaking initiative, as I indicated, without sort of a real deep dive analysis of where the cause, root cause of the problems are. The CFTC, as I've alluded to and Ryan has alluded to, has reporting obligations with respect to derivatives, but those reporting obligations were not in effect at the time they were putting this number in effect. And so this really was a sort of a finger in the air, watching the wind blow number, and it, you know, sort of was, people were kind of asked, what do you think about $8 billion? And the reality, interestingly enough, is that most of the firms didn't have a very good handle on what their numbers were and had to go start thinking about that. The number $8 billion is actually a gross notional number. So actually, if you buy a $100 million swap notional value and then you sell a $100 million swap, you've done $200 million of notional value, even though the net effect of that would be to zero out your risk. So the regulators kind of making up as they go along. I think the beauty, of course, is, of course, they could change their mind, and if they found the number was too high or too low, adjusted. In this case, actually, they have proposed to reduce it absent some intervening event.
Right. So the $8 billion number is where the final rule came out. It marks itself down to $3 billion at the end of 2017, so now just 3 years away. And that is written into the rule as a mandatory phase down to this $3 billion level. The commission articulated that it was concerned the $8 billion might be too high, but it didn't want to risk implementing the swap dealer registration requirement too quickly. I think what we've seen, however, on the industry side is that the $8 billion number, it appears to be appropriate. It's not as if no one has registered as a swap dealer. Nearly every financial institution that we anticipated to register has come in and registered. And slowly but surely, the commercial firms that have made the business decision to continue a derivatives dealing business are also keeping track of their notional amounts, and those entities are registering with the commission as well. And we can see this, so I'll move away from the swap dealer registration requirements, but I want to briefly touch on the reporting, clearing, and exchange trading. We went through a similar proposal, public comment, and final rule process. And with reporting, I think it's interesting to look at some of the substantive issues that drove the comment process. The commission was proposing that every swap, and this is required in the statute, that every swap would be reported, one, in real time to the CFTC, which the CF, or to what they call a swap data repository, which is sort of an entity that is registered with the CFTC but is a private entity that receives the swap reports. And the CFTC would also require swaps to be reported through the swap data repository to the commission. In terms of real-time reporting and as to how swaps were going to be made public, the CFTC's proposal did not necessarily distinguish between those swaps that, if made public, would reveal either too much or an inappropriate scope of information about the underlying transaction that would potentially reveal either the identities of the counterparties or the trading strategies of the counterparties. So the real-time reporting requirement was proposed that a swap would be sent to the swap data repository as soon as technologically practicable. I think that's come out to be in the 15 to 30 minute range and sooner for electronically executed trades. And what the swap data repository would do is then publish that trade on what is similar to the tickers we see in the bond or the stock markets, with the name stripped out, but the pricing, the terms, and the underlying commodity of the swap issued for the public to review. What we had then was end users who typically are not, remember, Dodd-Frank was addressing swaps in the bilateral space. And so these are customized, tailored swaps. And large end users, particularly in the that use swaps to manage or hedge their energy price risk, for example, airlines, are typically doing swaps in very large notional amounts relative to what you might see on an exchange. And if a swap with a large notional amount is, and with terms that are generally required by a specific customer, for example, an airline, if the terms of that swap are published in real time to the market can then anticipate what a particular end user, they can review the terms of the transaction and then understand, okay, we see this airline has entered into this transaction. Although their name is not associated with the publicly available information, there are only a few companies that are able to enter into certain types of transactions. And so this was a real concern. And what the CFTC did in a final rule was to more carefully tailor the scope of transactions that had to be made publicly available. And they also built in a delay for what they called large block trades. So if a trade was of a large notional amount, the CFTC was going to permit the public reporting of those trades to be delayed either several hours or a day, which would then allow both of the counterparty or the customer and the swap dealer to take whatever steps they needed to offset the risk to offset the risk they received as a part of entering into the trade in the first instance.
Just interject, yeah, and just to elaborate on your concern about reporting a bit, one of the concerns that many dealers have and that many customers also had was that in many of these markets, I mean, there's an enormous range of obviously OTC derivatives that can be traded in swap form, but to take the airline example, many of these markets are small enough that when other market participants see that print, as we would say, to the tape or that report of the transaction, sophisticated participants can, probably make a pretty good guess not only who the customer is and who the counterparty might be, but also at the hedging activities that those counterparties may engage in after entering into the swap to the extent they haven't engaged in already. And it's difficult to overstate the quickness and the acumen of traders in these small markets. So for instance, there's a real concern on the part of parties that when you show that you entered into a jet fuel swap that runs out for X period of time on this thousands of gallons of jet fuel, that other market participants will jump in ahead of you to get long that jet fuel or to short the jet fuel if they think you're going to do that.
Right, but exactly okay. Right.
So anyway, the swapper, I guess on a slightly related note, the reporting obligation is a tremendous logistical challenge to the swap dealers, as you would imagine, particularly when we're required to report it within the kind of time frames that we're talking about, and the amount of time and effort that has gone into building those pipes to channel that information from a trading desk through to the operations department and get the data out to the swap repository within the required amount of time has been just enormous. Although I've got to say I think the operations and the banking departments across the street have done a pretty impressive job of addressing it to date.
Sort of an example where the words seem easy, the implementation not so much so. I mean, the word transparency almost has an apple pie quality. Of course you want all the trades to be transparent. Everybody should be able to see all the trades, but obviously to the extent that chills people from participating, that obviously is not a healthy development, and there needs to be a balance brought. The one good thing about sort of the chaos created by a Dodd-Frank initiative and the complexity of the CFTC rulemakings specifically and the amount of volume that they had is that they were it was necessary for them, and they were in fact very willing to listen to the marketplace's commentary. And as Ryne indicated, I think the de minimis test is a good example. The numbers, could change 80-fold from where they proposed to where they went final. A lot of times when you're dealing with the government in other areas, they go out for public comment, and frankly, it's just a process that's there for window dressing, but they've already made their mind up and there will be no changes. These things were really pretty radically reformed because they were, in addition to the complexity, the lack of information, they were also under a severe time constraint. And to be blunt about it, the prior to the Dodd-Frank Act, many of you might remember, this is ancient history now, but there was something called the Commodity Futures Modernization Act, CFMA, for those of us who were living with that for the decade it was around. And the CFMA basically directed that the CFTC should not get involved in the swaps market. It was not even, you know, you have a little choice or whatever. There was a firm direction that they were not to audit, not to get reports on, not to be involved in the bank's activity in that space. So they were basically called upon in Dodd-Frank to be experts in a market that Congress had told them right up until Dodd-Frank's adoption that they were not permitted to be involved in. And so they were trying to develop these rules, you know, sort of writing, if you will, from a very clean board. They didn't have a whole background of expertise or knowledge. And so even something as fundamental as, you know, how big is the swaps market and what would be the impact of a de minimis threshold, you know, they were really dependent upon the industry and fortunately listening to a large extent to the industry's inputs.
Right, and I'll go through two more quick substantive examples to demonstrate this again, to also give you a bit more background knowledge on where the substance ended up. The Dodd-Frank Act included a clearing requirement, and so over-the-counter swaps would be, instead of bilateral agreements between two counterparties, were going to be where the CFTC required them to so be, sent to central clearinghouses. And as with reporting, as with transparency, the idea was that central clearing is good, how is clearing bad, who wouldn't want to clear? You take out one element of risk in a trade, the first element of risk being the trade itself, so the movement of the price of a commodity, the movement of a credit index, the second element of risk being that of your counterparty. And so the CFTC, moving from that direction in the statute, issued a proposal to require certain trades to be cleared. And so the CFTC had to identify the scope of products that were going to be subject to the clearing requirement. They started with two categories, which was interest rate swaps and credit derivative swaps. So these, you'll note, these are separate from any sort of derivatives or trades on physical commodities. So energy, metals, and agricultural commodities, we still haven't gotten to in the context of required clearing for over-the-counter swaps trades. But going back to interest rates and credit derivatives, it wasn't as simple as the CFTC proposing to require all interest rate swaps and credit derivative swaps to be cleared. Rather, the CFTC obviously had to calibrate what the scope of interest rate swaps would be and what the scope of credit derivative swaps were going to be to covered by the regulation. With interest rate swaps, the CFTC had to identify first, well, with interest rates, you have both currencies and you have specific rates or indexes. So they had to identify the major currencies and the factors that contributed to whether or not a product would be covered by the clearing requirement were going to be liquidity, the volume that is traded in that particular contract and observed by the CFTC, and more particularly, whether or not a specific contract is already being cleared voluntarily by market participants. So with interest rates, the CFTC was able to achieve a pretty good balance of identifying those trades that were already being cleared by the major clearing houses, not entirely, but on a voluntary basis by the swap dealers in the market. And so they picked up the trades with US dollar, euro, a couple Asian currencies, Japanese yen. So really the dollar, the pound, the euro, and Japanese yen. And then they identified certain interest rate curves, for example, LIBOR for the US dollar or EURIBOR for the euro. And then with yen, there's yen LIBOR. So the most liquid and the most commonly traded interest rate swaps were those that were covered by the clearing requirement. And what made the first step not less controversial than, for example, the swap dealer registration rules was that you already had a large clearinghouse, LCH, in London, and I believe ICE as well, already clearing certain of these interest rate swaps. On the ICE side, they were already clearing credit index swaps under the iTrax system. And so those are indexes that cover US corporate credit indexes and European corporate credit indexes. So what the CFTC was able to analyze and identify was where certain trades were already in the clearing system, and they sort of phased in the first round of clearing requirements with that gauge. And The second tier question, which is still somewhat up in the air, was whether or not the tenors of a particular interest rate contract, for example, when you look across the interest rate swaps spectrum, you have the most common or what they call on the run swaps. So a 2 year, a 5 year, a 10 year, a 30 year swap. But what comments asked the CFTC to consider was what happens to a 5 year swap the day after it's executed. It's now 4 years and 364 days. And that particular swap is not going to have the liquidity that a 5 year swap would have. And so market participants had asked the CFTC to consider narrowing the scope of the clearing requirement to only on the run swaps, particularly in the interest rate space. That's not necessarily where the CFTC's final rule came out. And so we have an instance where a swap that may not have the liquidity for in the clearing space that we would hope to see is nonetheless subject to the clearing requirement. And so I don't know if Gordon wants to discuss how your traders have dealt with either liquidity changing or the scope of available counterparties being mitigated by the clearing requirement or any of the other CFTC requirements.
Yeah, I'm a little just because I live in an equities world, I'm a little removed from our interest rate swaps. I will say, interest rates are, interest rates and CD and standardized CDS are far and away, I think, the most liquid items in the market. They were a logical place for the CFTC to start with mandatory clearing and trading. And to a large extent, they are pretty automated. So they are, fairly susceptible to this. But I can't tell you, unfortunately, what they've done about the,
Can you speak to sort of the SEC, we haven't spoken about this, but the SEC is a little bit behind in terms of some of these initiatives, but sort of where you see the SEC vis-a-vis what Ryne has laid out from the CFTC's perspective.
Well, I think the SEC is going to have, I think it's going to be quite a different environment for the SEC when we see some final security-based swap rules because of the quite different nature of the security-based swaps markets. For instance, in the interest-based market, participants trade among one another. It's an extremely liquid market. You can access prices on screens. Participants trade among one another based upon their mutual credit ratings, and it's fairly formulaic. When you move over, say, to the security-based swap world, most of that is going to be total return swaps. A large number of those will be total return swaps on equities, baskets of equities, and, equity index swaps are actually swaps, and they're within the CFTC's world, but they're traded by essentially the same people that are trading security-based swaps, which raises a different issue in that we've got desks that are trading security-based swaps and swaps at the same time, as well as mixed swaps. We won't get into that right now, but swaps that combine elements of foreign currency and equity price risk. I think the challenge for the SEC around clearing is going to be that in order for a clearing organization to clear something, they need to be able to value it. When dealers write a counterparty a security-based swap on an equity, say if UBS writes a dealer or writes a counterparty a swap on General Electric shares with a notional of $10 million. In order to centrally clear that, the central clearing organization needs to be able to make a judgment as to how much collateral it wants to collect to cover the day-to-day risk of changes in value to that swap. That clearing decision, banks make this decision every day. They make that decision based upon their perception of the volatility and the attributes of the underlier. I think that's going to be difficult for central clearing organizations to do. At the moment, we're not seeing a lot of movement towards central clearing of security-based swaps for that reason. It's out there on the horizon, in theory. But because of just the fundamentally different nature of the product, I think it's going to be a much more challenging go than what we're seeing right now in the fixed income markets.
And is there an explanation from your perspective as to why the SEC is sort of taking the tack they're taking vis-a-vis the tack that CFTC is taking in terms of certainly getting rules out?
I mean, our perception is they, well, not entirely. I mean, obviously, they are operating on a slower timetable. In some cases, they've missed some deadlines. Our perception is that they are intend to copy the CFTC's rules to a more, you know, a greater or lesser extent, probably greater, but that those rules may not be identical, which is also a worry for us as dealers, because again, we in the financial world, we are swap, you know, UBS, for instance, is a swap dealer. It's also a security-based swap dealer. We haven't had to register as that yet, but we're in process now of getting ready to do that. To the extent we are faced with differing sets of rules for security-based swaps versus swaps, obviously that creates one more logistical complication for us and for all dealers in the market. So in a way, I guess, I don't know if hope is the right word, but I mean, to some extent, we hope that the rules will be the same, simply because that makes life easier, you know, without regard to how much we like or you know, disagree with particular rules.
Yeah, I mean, I think we probably a different seminar for a different day, but the there have been discussions as long as the CFTC has been around about merging it with the SEC, in part because of these kinds of complexities for market users. However, it is worth noting, as folks at the SEC are prone to do, that the split on derivatives is about 95% of the jurisdictional volume rests with the CFTC in terms of the notional volume of OTC derivatives versus about 5% to the SEC. So while obviously anybody who's on the desk offering a security-based swap wants that to be harmonized, the CFTC taking the lead with those that greater degree of responsibility, it's not a surprise that they would be moving somewhat more quickly. Also, it's fair to say that for the CFTC, this was their first, second, and third priority, whereas at the SEC, I think there were a number of other priorities in terms of market structure and a lot of other issues that are beyond the scope of today's
program. And the SEC had things like the Jobs Act to contend with as well, which they also fell a bit behind.
And I think both of those comments highlight a key criticism of the process on the CFTC side, which was they were simply going about it too quickly or imprecisely or not appropriately taking into account the comments they were receiving. I'll first demonstrate sort of how this was seen in practice through the comment process. The CFTC received input. So traditionally, they would receive the input in the traditional way through comment letters. They do the proposal and they get the comment letters, and that happened. But what the CFTC also used was several other administrative law tools to receive public comment and public input on the process. We had roundtables on proposals. You also saw actual members of Congress reaching out to the agency, either directly or through different committees, whether in the House or the Senate, to give the commission either further guidance or suggestions on substantive results that should follow the proposals the CFTC had made. And so I know this happens in any administrative process, but I think as the CFTC moved very quickly, really over a period of 2 years from 2011 to 2013, to propose and finalize its rules, it received quite a bit of feedback directly from members of Congress, either urging it to slow down, to further take time to consider the public comments that were coming in, and to calibrate its rules more appropriately. And this sort of manifest...
Or to speed up and keep the
good point. Yeah, right. There was input from both sides of the aisle, as it could be said. And so that's right. The comments came both ways, and the CFTC very much became a political agency during that time. And as you saw in the final rules, the rules would sometimes achieve a result, perhaps for a political purpose, but maybe not that was practical or workable on the business side. And therefore, the CFTC, they developed almost what you would call a practice or a habit of, after issuing any final rule, the commenters in this case became either the trade associations for the users of derivatives. Those are going to be ISDA or SIFMA, or there were end user coalitions that were put together. There were small farm coalitions. There were agricultural commodity type interests, for example, National Council of Farmer Cooperatives that came in. And almost invariably, as the CFTC would finalize a rule, those advocacy efforts would start to set up meetings with commissioners and staff to explain how notwithstanding the final rule, it is not possible for us to implement that regulation. And the CFTC, to their credit, or we can pick the best word, to their credit, they accepted those meetings and they went through the tools they had to respond to the further comments that followed the final rules. Specifically, right. Well, they use, yeah, go ahead.
Ryne, I was wondering also if you could just tell us a little bit about what happens when when these interest groups come into the CFTC and make a comment. What actually happens?
Right, so the advocacy process, I think that is a whole game in itself. And so I will get to that. Okay. The end result was the CFTC, after issuing the final rules, also issued more than 100 informal, either no action letters, guidance letters, quasi-interpretive statements, or other forms of agency and staff advisories that were outside of the formal public comment process. And I think that was at least a recognition on behalf of the agency that even though they had final rules, there was plenty of further calibration still needed. In terms of the advocacy strategies and efforts that the agency was presented with, typically you would have, we can use a trade group for example. The trade group would review a final rule and they would identify in good faith where the rule was presenting implementation challenges for their members, whether their members were a group of banks, whether their members were a group of end users of derivatives, for example, commercial energy companies. And they would come to the commission and they would set up individual meetings with the different commissioners, sort of, and they would get their expert advice beforehand of the political background and motivations and obligations of a particular commissioner. And they would then explain to the commissioner how the rule, as implemented, would impact their business and would impose cost on them that the commission certainly had not considered in finalizing the rule. And then they would also take those efforts, when it was appropriate, to Congress to sort of continue the lobbying beyond the statute to ask Congress to put together either inquiries, letters, or phone calls in some cases back to commissioners to sort of encourage the development of these implementation and phasing informal advisories that were issued.
And in each case, these contacts with the CFTC are reflected in a Sunshine Act, ex-party communication. Actually, you can, in the new transparent world, you can actually get on your iPhone the CFTC link, and they will send you every time they announce an ex-party meeting. And they'll also, oftentimes, the subject matter and the participants will be displayed in sometimes some detail.
Right. There are certainly the news articles that come out, and this is because news articles must be written. But they would say certain commissioner met with this trade group so many times. This another commissioner is only meeting with agricultural interest. A third commissioner seems to be spending an inordinate amount of time with either interest or representatives from the financial industry. But I think on the whole, that results in a good administrative process and a better implementation result of the rules. And I mean, maybe Ken can speak a bit more to this. The flexibility of the commission to phase in its rules has actually allowed it, as an end result, to say that Dodd-Frank and the four major purposes of Dodd-Frank, which is registration, reporting, clearing and trading, are in place and starting to become part of a new market paradigm, sort of in the way market participants trade and interact and are regulated. And I think if the CFTC had not used or embraced the idea of flexibility in implementing the rules, you probably would not be in a place today where there have only been a handful of lawsuits challenging particular Dodd-Frank rules. There certainly could have been more, but there have only been a handful. For the most part, I believe market participants have taken the rules and engaged in efforts to implement them and comply with the new regulatory structure. Obviously, the overarching comment is the CFTC could have taken an approach like the SEC and done a more phased-in proposal process and timed it more, kind of allowed more time for comments and fine-tuning of rules to develop before seeking to achieve implementation. I think on the political side, that was probably not a possibility or a realistic possibility for the CFTC during the time period of 2011 to 2013.
Yeah, I mean, I think that
Ryne, how difficult or easy is it? How well do the CFTC and SEC work together? For instance, we saw them issue a joint release on product definitions, defining those things that were swaps, security-based swaps, and mixed swaps. Is that a difficult process or a time-consuming process?
Agencies work together. So this is, now we're getting very much into my personal opinion and not representative of anything or anyone. But agencies are very much driven by two things. One is the relationship of a particular chairman or leadership head at one agency with the chairman or leadership head at another agency. And I think we observed during the Dodd-Frank implementation time period that Chairman Gary Gensler and SEC Chairman Mary Shapiro, they had a good relationship. I think they were friends in real life, which was always helpful. But the two also had common goals under the administration of implementing the same statute. The second factor that is very important to consider is the either sway or influence that staff at an agency have over what the agency can put effort behind and accomplish. CFTC staff and SEC staff do work well together. They achieved the final Dodd-Frank swap definitions and the swap dealer definitions, but you also run into some legacy issues about jurisdictional grabs or jurisdiction protection, protecting the jurisdiction of your agency. I think that was observed a bit in the Dodd-Frank process.
Just to speak on Ryan's point, in particular, the rulemaking process, even though specified by Congress with deadlines and among other sort of amusing facts, is that the Dodd-Frank Act, which the Title VII provisions alone are 800 pages, initially, Congress wanted to give the agency 90 days to implement the statute. Ultimately, they gave them a full year, which was ridiculous in terms of the ability to get things done. But I think that under Gary Gensler's leadership, there was a lot of drive to get these rules in place, and the feeling was, let's get them in place, and if we need to correct them or we need to give some time-limited extensions for implementation, we'll do that, but we'll get everybody's attention and get everybody focused and get people to move from sort of the lobbying campaign on the rule itself to the implementation campaign of getting their back office and their operations people up to speed to make these things work. And I think that a different chairman could have taken a more leisurely or more interactive approach, but as far as getting things done, then I think, Gordon can speak to this, but from the industry's perspective, obviously they'd like it perfect, maybe they'd like it, you know, sort of the way it was before the statute was adopted, but more than anything else, I think the banks and the others who are in the regulated space want to know what the rules are and get on with it. Let's go ahead and put those rules in place, let's go ahead and get the people trained, and let's start doing business. The uncertainty is actually a bigger negative, I think, than anything else.
That's exactly right. I mean, when we lawyers in the banks interact with our clients, and you guys experience this as well, what the clients want to know are, what are the rules? What do we need to do? They may not be happy about what they need to do, but they recognize that the law has changed, new regulations have come out, and they need to do something. But they do need to know what they do. And we actually go through quite a process in the banks when the rules come out. Within our bank and many banks, we've got a process where we create something called a rule map. And we have some very talented consultants who will literally break down the rule into its most granular elements. If a rule says, adopt policies and procedures to do X, Y, and Z, they will break that down into its most minute elements and say, okay, adopt a policy, that requires salespeople to provide material economic terms disclosures to counterparties prior to entry into a swap. They will then further break that down and identify, who's going to create the policy. How will we ensure that this, what we call METS disclosures are delivered? Who's going to deliver it? Who will be responsible for creating the disclosures? How will we maintain a record that the disclosures have been maintained? And what we wind up with are enormous spreadsheets that can't be printed on ordinary paper. And this is a process that involves obviously not just the legal department or the compliance department, but our operations departments, our sales staffs, our trading desks, and all of our support functions, we will wind up, you know, for any given rule, with an enormous spreadsheet showing exactly who's going to do what, who needs to write a policy, who needs to create a process, who needs to create a feed from one system to another system, who needs to create a disclosure to be placed on a website or delivered to a client. And this process goes on for, you know, every rule at the most granular level when they're released. And so, you know, one of the critical elements to us always is, when's the rule going to be finalized? Because we know we've got to get this process going, and it takes months and months.
Yeah, and I, you know, I can't understate how profound a change Dodd-Frank is for the financial institutions that are both swap dealers and participants in these new execution and clearing platforms. The requirements that are imposed upon them from pretty much a sort of threshold of prudent business decision making to a hundreds, or if not thousands, of pages in the Federal Register of legal requirements and rules and regulations about their behaviors, as well as a whole host of sort of unknowns about, does this apply to us or not? The rule is not clear on that, you know, and a variety of interpretive steps. So we're now, you know, through the leadership of the Gary Gensler particularly and the CFTC, we're now at that phase where we have a lot of implementation already under our belt and interpretations about the subtleties of requirements that are imposed by those new regulations is really the centerpiece of discussion rather than notice and comment record, you know, rulemakings that we're writing comment letters on, although we are still doing a few of those.
Well, 2 points that I'll add into that. One is to identify really, as Ken mentioned, Dodd-Frank included a one-year period for the agencies to write all the rules. And so when Dodd-Frank first came out, there were these regulatory trackers, or people identified how many different rulemaking requirements were in the rule itself. And I think even on the CFTC side, it was certainly over 50. And at the end of the day, the CFTC proposed well more than 100 rulemakings, orders, and other items. And if you look past, if you look back in the CFT's history, a normal year would involve between 1 to 5 substantive rulemaking proposals, and then those 1 to 5 proposals would go through a comment process and result in a final rule, perhaps 18 months or 2 years after the original proposal. I think that's a typical timeline. And then you move into the period of 2011 to 2013, where we have 100 proposals and 70 final rules in a period of 24 months, completely anomalous in the context of what the agency was geared up and staffed to do. And that leads me to my second point, which is the agency itself is somewhat constrained by the resources that it has in terms of continuing to operate at this pace. I think in 2010, the CFTC was able to get some increases in its funding in terms of hiring even additional bodies on the ground, additional staff, to gear up for the Dodd-Frank rule writing effort. What the CFTC never received and still doesn't have is funding to properly staff an implementation and ongoing monitoring effort of the regulatory program that is in place. And so you have seen their proposal process slow down. The CFTC is not issuing a new proposal every week now. They're still doing pretty good about getting them out every month or two on issues that are open-ended, but they have slowed down in terms of releasing proposals on the regular basis they had done over the 2 years. And in part that is due to the funding issues they're having with Congress. I think Congress got to a point where the political balance shifted slightly, and so they don't have the consensus to either pull back or drill down into and remove the provisions of Dodd-Frank, the substantive requirements. What they do have is less consensus on budget and what to fund certain agencies and at what levels to fund those agencies. And so the president consistently asked for, sort of in the administration's budget, a higher amount for the CFTC. And then Congress, I think it's in the $300 million per year range. The CFTC has ended up getting in the range of $195 million. And so it's roughly 66 to 70% of what the agency was hoping to get in terms of being fully funded. And so I think that does have an effect on how fast the agency can realistically expect compliance to happen if it clearly does not have the ability to implement and monitor the regulations.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there are teams at the CFTC who worked on developing these rules. There are teams who worked on finalizing the rules. Then their teams that have worked on registering all of the various categories, whether they be swap dealers or these new swap execution facilities. But the need that the industry has for input from the agency on interpretive guidance is really profound, and the ability of the agency to provide it is somewhat limited. This creates some real friction because, I think from Gordon's perspective and inside the bank, they want clear guidance. It's not, I wouldn't say they're indifferent to which way the guidance goes, but they certainly are much more interested in the guidance definitively than the uncertainty about it. So this is really causing some severe friction, and for the CFTC staff, the budgetary limitations are really severe. I should point out when Ryne mentions that there are 100 rulemakings and the like, that the average length of one of these proposals is basically about 300 pages in type form. It's shorter, and when you shrink it down in the Federal Register, but you do the math and you think about the CFTC. The agency has, I think now, about 700 employees, something in that range, and some of those people are in enforcement, and some of those people are in sort of the operations department. There are not a lot of those people who are actually writing those rules. So a lot of writing going on in an agency that for an agency not resourced and also not expert in the subject matter for the reasons I described earlier.
And so I guess it's important to recall they still regulate the futures market, which is what they did from 1936 until 2010. In 2010, their jurisdiction it either doubled or expanded multiple fold, depending on how you evaluate the size and scope of their duties on the swaps market.
Yeah, I mean, they thought before Dodd-Frank was adopted, they thought that they were fully staffed. It wasn't like they had a couple hundred extra people, sort of sitting around waiting for things to do. They were fully deployed in a futures industry that we haven't spent any time talking about, but has been itself rapidly growing and evolving in a number of interesting ways, both domestically and globally. And so their expertise was deployed in that space and needed to be redeployed in its derivative space.
So I think it's worth looking at some of the consequences sort of on the market side in practice of what changes we have seen in response to Dodd-Frank. One that I might ask Ken to speak about is called futurization. And this is the idea that, I'll give a bit of background. So in October 2012, the CFTC had pinpointed that date, so October 12th actually, is the date on which you had to count your swaps, you had to start counting your swaps and towards this $8 billion threshold number we talked about earlier. So as we approached October 12th, 2012, market participants, many who were in the swaps markets had to face the decision as to whether they were going to remain in those markets and perhaps risk exceeding the $8 billion level, and which Ken noted earlier, it can be approached fairly quickly by a trader of any of significant size, particularly when you're opening and closing trades. You're left with no net position, but you have to count both the opening and closing of a trade towards your notional exposure of the $8 billion. And so market participants looked for ways, as we move towards October 2012, to continue to transact their derivatives trading activity, but to avoid having their amounts count towards the swap dealing threshold. And this is particularly because in the energy industry, you saw this the most, they simply didn't view themselves as swap dealers. They didn't feel like they had anything to do with the financial crisis. They're entering into swaps in connection with hedging and managing price exposure to oil, natural gas, electricity, and otherwise. And these were very developed and mature swaps markets that were either cleared or had very healthy bilateral relationships where we didn't see the issues. Certainly this was argued that led to the crisis. And so they wondered, why is the CFTC's swap dealer rules aiming to cover this scope of the market that was not involved in the activity related to the housing bubble, credit default swaps, and otherwise? And so they looked for ways to continue derivatives activity, but not necessarily count that activity towards the swap dealer threshold.
Yeah, I mean, I think that Dodd-Frank Act itself and the CFTC's implementation of it was heavily influenced by what was perceived then as a very safe and sound trading environment and clearing and execution environment which was the environment that existed for futures. And so they had already at the CFTC, 75 years of regulation of futures in various forms, they had expertise and comfort around that. So to a large extent, the Dodd-Frank Act implementation of derivatives regulation was really following that same futures model. The futures model being that the market participant, in this case the market maker rather than just the broker, needs to be registered, although they also required that people who broker swaps need to be registered. And that's a key initial component. And then you have execution, public execution environments on exchanges, or now these swap execution facilities, which look a lot like exchanges, and you have clearing. So you already have sort of the broad umbrella of a futurized world. A number of market players decided to convert their swaps, which had elements of a futures look-alike, to just doing them as futures, and thereby avoid the requirement to comply with the Dodd-Frank specific initiatives, and were able, actually, interestingly enough, those of you who are sort of knowledgeable in this, is in the security space, there always has been the concept of a broker-dealer. You have to register if you either broker transactions or you're a market maker or a dealer in transactions. In the futures world, only the broker had to register. You could be a market maker in futures and you would not have to register. There was no dealer equivalent. Obviously, the swap dealer embraced the dealer model, embraced the SEC notion that a dealer had to register. So a number of these players decided, well, I'm happy to be a dealer, but let me move my dealing business from the swap space to the future space and thereby avoid having to register as a swap dealer. The reality of this initiative is that it has worked and has been particularly popular in the physical commodity space. However, the CFTC itself has various proposals that they haven't yet rolled out that really raise questions as to whether that model is sustainable or whether they want to force people back to the swap space rather than using futures as a substitute. So this is one of the policy initiatives that's still very much in play. Was there a question back there? Yes.
Just a small question. From a commercial point of view, how much have the council become swap dealers? Are there any estimates on that?
Yes, actually. Well, yeah, I mean, I think that what we've seen is that it turns out that there are very few players, and in fact, when we've talked to clients about this, who are at the $8 billion level. A number of firms do $8 billion worth of swaps a day. I mean, so for them, I would say if you took somebody who was just at the $8 billion threshold, the cost of being a swap dealer would overwhelm the profitability of being in that space. If you're doing, a trillion or so, or multiple trillions, it's a little bit easier to do the calibration. At a minimum, because among other things, you've got to hire a chief compliance officer, you have a number of very specific compliance obligations, new reporting obligations and the like. You know, it's been said by a number of people it's at least a $5 million number. But I think that number is way low. I don't know if, Gordon, you have an ability to estimate it.
I don't have any ability to estimate it, but it's in the millions. I mean, when you add up the infrastructure changes you've got to make, the operations changes you've got to make, the enhanced compliance infrastructure, the reporting, I mean, it's yes, I'd say $5 million is low. It's a big number. It's a number that, the swap dealer market is, I don't know if oligopoly is the right word, but I mean, it's a relatively limited, as Ryne mentioned, roughly 80, I think, to 85 firms have registered as swap dealers. Most of those are pretty, there's a first tier and then maybe a second and third tier that come in behind that, but most of the activity is done by the largest dealers. For those dealers, there was and is no question that they were going to register whatever the cost. But certainly, as Ken mentioned, for anybody who's at the threshold, I would think, I would not be surprised to see somebody in that situation make a commercial decision to reduce their swaps activity to avoid the registration requirement.
Yeah, and separate from futurization, which is one way to go, a number of commercials are dealers in the physical commodity. That is, they'll basically make you a market for jet fuel. Not for a jet fuel swap, but actually to deliver you jet fuel. And they can continue to do that in an unregulated way. The question of whether they want to add this extra service is really for them a cost-benefit analysis. And to date, in the commercial space, there are, I think, only, I might not have current events here, but I think there are only three companies that I'm aware of, Cargill, BP, and Shell, that have registered as swap dealers. So the others have elected to either migrate over to futurization or to just deal in the physical commodity and avoid, or otherwise monitor their activities to stay under the $8 billion number, which, as we indicated, would not be much of a business in the swap space.
And Cargill, I think, registered in a limited capacity.
Correct.
As a swap dealer only for certain commodities and not others.
Right. There are all kinds of little provisions in the Dodd-Frank Act, oftentimes advocated by various market participants, but one of them is that you could be a sort of special purpose swap dealer, and you could have your swap dealer inhabit a bigger company and not have the bigger company's capital and otherwise be regulated, so that the regulation only focuses on the swap dealing activity of, in this case, the Cargill entity. It's sort of an interesting interpretation that they came out with there.
But I think it's good to drill into the usefulness of the limited designation status for Cargill, and that is driven by a general theme of Dodd-Frank, which is end users, which we view as, you know, the buyers and sellers and producers and merchants handling physical commodities in the U.S. economy are not part of the financial, I guess, the financial market landscape, and that Dodd-Frank should, as a final result, have a light touch on those entities. And so if you look inside Cargill, they have a division that does swap dealing activity. For example, they stand ready to make markets for customers on different swap trades, typically physical commodity swaps, but I'm sure, I don't know the specifics, but they have a division that is able to stand ready to enter into a trade with you and offer you a price, whether or not they're also looking to enter that trade themselves. And what they will then do is offset the risk they gain by entering into a trade with a customer by going to the market and offsetting their risk. What Cargill has separately is a series of swap dealing and just physical market capabilities where they deal with their farmers and other physical commodity end user customers in a way that is not dealing, but that is in a way to facilitate the hedging needs and other purposes of their customers. And so throughout the Dodd-Frank, we see this idea of hedging, and if you're hedging physical commodity price risk, even using derivatives, that's not the type of activity that we're going to that the statute and that Congress is viewing as the swap dealing or financial market activity that needs to be subject to heightened regulation. If you look at the clearing requirement, there's an explicit exemption in the statute called the end user exemption from the requirement to clear a trade. And so to the extent a company is using interest rate swaps or credit indexes, probably on that would be less common, but certainly with interest rate swaps, to hedge either their loans or other interest rate risks they're exposed to in connection with their commercial business, or in connection with commercial activity, they do not have to clear that trade. There's sort of the question as to why wouldn't an end user want to clear a trade? Wouldn't they want to limit the scope of their risk to their counterparty? But you'll find that end users either have long-standing relationships or the ability to enter into relationships bilaterally, perhaps on better credit terms in terms of the margin that is required to be posted and the different types of assets that could be posted as margin to their counterparty, as opposed to what the clearinghouse will require. A clearinghouse is going to have set margin requirements and will only accept certain types of assets, whereas if a commercial end user is trading directly with a bilateral counterparty, that counterparty can build into the terms of the swap either credit conditions or I guess other factors that allow the commercial end user to avoid putting up, you know, in many instances, a large amount of cash. They can, for example, say, I have a lot of oil in the ground. I have certain physical assets that I can't monetize at the moment, but instead of putting up margin to you that we hold in, you know, either in a third-party account, why don't we securitize the swap and my obligations on the swap with other assets that I couldn't particularly use at a clearinghouse? And so the theme is end users, that they're sort of given a special look under the Dodd-Frank Act. Similarly, we didn't touch on this too much earlier, but the swap execution facility requirement in the statute is going to require, I guess starting in February actually, the interest rate and credit index trades to be traded on these new swap execution facilities, which are sort of public marketplaces, similar to futures markets, but different in certain ways. End users, for the same reasons they don't always want to clear a trade, they don't always want to go into the public marketplace and expose their either need or interest in a particular swap to more than one swap dealer. And this can be based on concerns they have about maintaining an existing relationship with a swap dealer that gives them favorable terms, or similar, also can be based on just keeping their business focused on their commercial activities and not having to be involved in the financial market side beyond what is necessary for their hedging activities.
Yeah, I mean, I think that this is sort of, the way in which Congress tries to navigate the vagaries of various interest groups and the like. And I think that there was there were a number of senators who challenged the drafters and the CFTC on this and said, why should there be any exceptions? Everybody should be eligible for and required to take on this this responsibility. I think that the reason that the end user group won was, I think, the point that Ryne made, is that they were able to convincingly point out, which one of the problems that I would observe with Dodd-Frank is that it might have started in reaction to the recession and the calamitous events to the economy, but it became untethered to that when they decided to develop rules in a variety of areas. And I think the end user community, particularly the energy end user community, went back to Capitol Hill and said, whoa, wait a second, remember, we didn't have anything to do with the collapse. We operated perfectly fine. Nobody defaulted on any of our transactions. Everybody was quite, you know, both the banks we dealt with and ourselves are very happy with the environment in which we operated. So don't impose these, you know, new obligations, because they're fixing a problem that didn't exist. And so I think they were able, in large part because a number of farmers and ranchers and energy players and the like, sort of real players in middle America economy, were really hit Washington in numbers, were able to convince this carve-out to happen. Otherwise, they would have been sucked up in the same vortex of having to trade everything in the public market. And for them, credit-wise and otherwise, it would be a big hit.
Right. So I think, I guess, as we move towards a conclusion, it'll probably be good. What I want to do is articulate how the world we see today, and so the world here, the derivatives market and derivatives market participants,
our world,
how our world is different than it was 4 years ago, and even, let's say, 6 or 7 years ago before Dodd-Frank was a glimmering in the eye. So the first major thing, which we've talked about kind of at length, is we have registered swap dealers. That market-facing, market-making activity that is, for the most part, carried out by the large financial institutions now have a new registration category. They're obviously registered with the Federal Reserve and as bank holding companies, probably with the OCC as national banks, or if they're from a foreign jurisdiction, registered there in some banking capacity. But now they have a new regulator. They're subject to the jurisdiction of the CFTC. They're going to start to have, over the next years, annual exams for the purpose of looking at their swap dealing business. The CFTC is going to go through with these what are newly appointed chief compliance officers, and they're going to have the chief compliance officer do annual reports explaining how the swap dealers are complying with the different conduct requirements, reporting requirements that they're now subject to. The next thing we're seeing,
two points. One is that Gordon and Ryne mentioned that there are about 82 or 83 swap dealers registered. However, there are a number of financial institutions that have multiple registrants. I think that Bank of America has six entities
right.
that are registered as swap dealers. So when you look at the number 80, it probably reduces to kind of more like a core of 30 or so. The other point to make is that a number of non-U.S. Either branches or affiliates of U.S. entities, maybe headquartered in non-U.S. locations, maybe headquartered in U.S. locations, are registered. So a number of banks are registered both in the United States and in their home country, in both cases under the CFTC swap dealer regime, and that, I guess, is true of UBS in terms of their registration.
Sure. I mean, as a foreign banking entity, we are a registered swap dealer here in the U.S., and we will be becoming a security-based swap dealer as well, and we're obviously subject to extensive regulation in our home country of Switzerland. and in and by the UK regulatory authorities in London, where the bulk of our swap and OTC derivative activities are booked.
Right. So you have this new registration category, and you have a new regulatory regime the registrants have to follow. I think the big thing, which we went through earlier as well, was reporting. We do have a public ticker tape of swap reports on a somewhat real-time basis. They're anonymized, of course. It's a no-name basis. But you can log into portals at what the registered swap data repositories, and you can see what you could not see 4 years ago, which is sort of a stream of swaps activity that is occurring on any given day. There are plenty of questions about the usefulness, preciseness, and general quality of the data that is coming out of the swap reporting requirements. I think it's viewed by all parties, regulator, market participants, and otherwise, as a work in progress. But so we have swap reporting that has started to happen. And obviously the last two is clearing and trading requirements. Clearinghouses have been clearing swaps for years. This is not a new thing, but the volume of what has been cleared, it's moved up noticeably. I don't think we've seen exponentially expanded volumes in terms of cleared interest rate and credit index swaps, but we have seen more of those products going into clearing and clearing houses. We've seen clearing houses expand what they offer in terms of products they will clear, and we've also seen different types of market participants move to clearing that had not, for example, banks that had not necessarily fully embraced clearing of their derivatives business have obviously started to move towards full clearing or clearing as much as they can because they're subject to the clearing requirements. And then the trade execution, which is the requirement where the trades that are required to be cleared must also occur on an exchange or exchange facility, it really starts to come into play this year in 2014. And so volumes on the first round of registered CEFs is what they're called, or swap execution facilities. They're still very much in their development phases, but I guess if we had this conversation again next year, we would look at what has happened on CEFs, what activity has migrated there, and where have end users chosen, even though they don't have to transact on CEFs, are they finding that the CEFs have developed in such a way that they either get better pricing, better service, or better execution there? And so that's a development I think that we'll be looking towards over the next year.
Yeah, happy to get a couple of questions if people have any. We haven't touched on a lot of other topics. There's a lot more material here. We haven't spoken about the Volcker rule or the FSOC or SIFIs or Lincoln pushout. There's a variety of issues that also are part of Dodd-Frank that I don't think are a lot of time lets us get into, but happy to take any questions that anybody has on what we've spoken about so far. Yes, certainly.
You touched a lot on invasion of regulation. Is there any understanding at CFTC or just about the systemic risk those participants pose by sort of being in this black hole below $8 billion of
Yeah, I think, one of the problems that exists is that the CFTC is really at the infancy of collecting data to be able to assess that. I think they're of the view, and I think this is largely accepted by old statistics from ISDA and the like, that, if you capture, and maybe the number way above $8 billion, in fact, you'll get, if you capture the top 10 or so dealers, you can name those sort of household names, you're probably well and above 90% of the dealing side of the market. I think that over time, certainly as 2017 ramping back to $3 billion and the like, that over time the CFTC might be interested in capturing that last 4 or 5%. But as far as resource allocation, as we talked about, limited resources to, pick up another 30 swap dealers who amount to 4%, whereas the first 30 gave you 94%, it probably is not a worthwhile enterprise. I think people would react accordingly. But I think we're going to learn more with this data. I think Ryne alluded to it. The CFTC actually went out about 10 days ago and asked for people to comment on their data collection because the first round has been so ineffective. Maybe not surprising because people are not used to doing it in the way it comes in. And as Gordon can highlight in great detail, swaps are not completely homogenized, standardized products. So you can't say, well, we just did 10 of those. They're exactly the same. Each one of those might be slightly different. So you have a 5-year tenor interest rate swap. That doesn't tell you, where the the start date and the day count and all these other variables. So the data is really not easily absorbed yet, and I think there's going to be some work to get that right.
Yeah, I mean, in fact, outside the most liquid markets like interest rates and you know the brand name CDX indexes, I think it's fair to say that almost every swap is different.
Please.
You raised the vault.
Right.
Can you comment on the status of the implementation of the rule now and what the consequences have been so far and what they're likely to be in the future?
Maybe I'll reserve that for a question for Jess Staley, who's going to give our keynote. I know he wants to speak a bit about that and spend a lot of time with that. So we'll, because that actually, that's not an easy question and it's not an easy answer. So it'd take us some time to cover that, but we'll make sure to come back to it. Yes.
Right. Could you comment on the effect of the implementation of the swaps rules on increasing or reducing or not affecting systemic risk?
Oof. yeah, I mean, obviously, the goal of Dodd-Frank, one of the very primary goals of Dodd-Frank was to reduce that systemic risk, reduce or eliminate the too big to fail. I think that by creating and mandating clearing and creating some transparency, I think they go a long way to do that. I think the worry that exists now and where a lot of attention is being focused is the clearinghouse itself. Is because what we've now done is we've taken risk away from the whole range of counterparts and moved it all to a central clearing location. And the question is that central clearing location the new next big to fail? And I think as a result of that fear or concern, the banking regulators, among others, global regulators, have been looking very carefully at the clearinghouse environment to kind of get more comfortable. I would say, unequivocally that systemic risk is reduced because there's a lot more focused attention, a lot more information being displayed and the like, but is it reduced to the degree that perhaps Congress represented to the American public it would be reduced? I think not, and I think there will always be tails in the economy that are going to come and hit you in some way, and right now I think that the fear is perhaps in the clearinghouse environment that that could be a place where, were there to be a default, it would have a lot of collateral consequences. So, I think the answer is we'll see. Yes?
All right. You guys touched on the limited purpose designation for a little bit, and I was wondering, do you think the benefits have outweighed the costs of applying for and implementing those limited purpose designations? Because I know that there's been a lot of conditions attached to
and to be clear, there's only one so far, so it's hard to make too many generalities, but yes.
Right, I mean, there might be states, there may be two, but right. It's been valuable for the companies that were able to get the designation. I think if you really drill down into it, you'll see that it was directly connected to advocacy efforts they put in the statutory and legislative process. In terms of risk of a limited designation, I think the CFTC did it in a good way. They're addressing the dealing side of, for example, the Cargill business, which we do, if it's over the $8 billion de minimis level, it represents a CFTC decision that needs to be a registered business. But then Cargill has a much broader business outside of that scope that does not pose the type of risk of dealing activity. And if you look at the Cargill limited designation order, for example, it says all their dealing activity has to occur inside of the limited designation business unit. And so the activity we're concerned about regulating does in fact occur inside of the registered space. So I think that was an important protection that was put in place.
Yes.
You had mentioned, right, you saw that there's no general consensus as to the reasons for the crisis. But there are two or three things, and I would appreciate if you could give us your views. One is that there have been any number of document instances where product was sold to the investor and simultaneously the institution was staying a negative bet without disclosure. So I'm talking about conflicts of interest. Second, we have created an environment where we have given a lot of subsidies to these institutions. So we have privatized the profits and socialize the law sector? And are there any steps taken to rectify that imbalance?
Yeah, let me take that on and let my co-panelists weigh in as well. I mean, on the second point, I think that is sort of at the core of the Volcker Rule, which we'll spend a little time talking about in the next panel. Certainly, the idea of using FDIC deposits, if you will, government-guaranteed deposits to engage in activities that were proprietary trading in nature, that I think is something that Congress was very well aware of and did manifest itself in the Volcker Rule. On the issue of conflicts, you know, obviously that some of those cases have been litigated, a lot of those cases have been settled. There are different views about how much was known, where diligence was appropriate, what were the realities of those transactions. You know, I think those are largely wending their way through the courts, and certainly based on the settlements that the banks have paid. And the reforms that they have made going forward, they obviously are aware of those risks, whether they could win those litigations or not. There are obviously a number of them being settled in order to put that behind them. And as a result, there are reforms that they've adopted because of their litigation risk. There's also reforms that have been adopted as a result of Dodd-Frank. The swap dealer space now requires that there be what they call external business conduct rules, which are rules of conduct in dealing with counterparties of a disclosure nature, among other things, and conflicts being a big part of it. So I think, you know, you might say if you overgeneralize what happened as a bubble during the roll-up to 2008, that in that bubble people got different levels of enthusiasm about investment opportunities and profit opportunities, and without perhaps a realization, not just from a disclosure perspective, but also obviously from the dealer perspective about, you know, the black swan or the fat tails that were at the edges, that those things could, quote, never happen in 1,000 years, but they happened that year, so that was a bad development. I do think that in those respects, Congress was very mindful of trying to solve for those problems, not easy to solve for. Yes, I think that'll be the last question, yes.
Thank you. Well, sort of on the same issue of going back to the causes and whether Congress addressed them about Frank or not, I guess you believe, it depends on what you believe the causes are. If you believe the causes were a combination of the monetary policy where the, you know, we don't have a free market monetary policy, we have a Federal Reserve that in effect give access to, in effect, free money to big financial institutions who had to, which created a bubble. We had a housing policy with GSEs and other government policies encouraging specifically the housing market bubble. And we had, going back, although it's long-term capital management, a policy of the government, in effect, ensuring too big to fail. So if you believe those three policies is what caused the collapse, Dodd-Frank is just exacerbating that, you know, tremendously. Because you have the Federal Reserve getting new power, you in effect increased concentration in the big banks, and there is nothing changed with GSEs, as you mentioned.
Right. Yeah, no, I think that because of the needed, but the haste with which Dodd-Frank was adopted, there probably has not been adequate reflection, in my opinion. There certainly was not adequate reflection in the development of Dodd-Frank about sort of what are the root causes and what's trying to cure. And as I mentioned, I think that Dodd-Frank became untethered to the recession fairly quickly into it, where they sort of said, okay, we want to do this, we want to do that. I mean, we haven't talked at all, but they wanted to put into place position limits on, because they thought there was excessive speculation. There wasn't really any evidence of that. And, you know, the variety of other things of that type that were part of the Dodd-Frank initiative. I'm hopeful that academics and others will, you know, sort of work through these issues for us and force us to be accountable for, you know, are we looking at solving these problems or not. I think that there are elements of Dodd-Frank that are designed to solve problems. They may not have been the problems that were the root cause of the recession itself. And I appreciate your comments. I think they're very valid as different, you know, as a point of view, And hopefully over time, people will hold people accountable for those events. We turn the program back over to you. What do we do next?
Yeah. So at this point, we're going to take a brief coffee break until about 11:15, and then right at 11:15 on the dot, we'd like to come back for our fireside chat keynote address. So we'll see you soon, and thank you, panelists.
Half the